I'm delighted to say that my colleague and dear friend, columnist Rick Coben, will appear in conversation with Daniel Woodrell, winner of the Chicago Tribune's 2014 Heartland Prize.
Daniel, welcome. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What does a prize like this mean to you?
It means a great deal to me, especially coming from Chicago, where so many of the writers who got me started seriously interested in being a writer seem to come from. And, you know, writing, I live way in the sticks. We don't even really have a bookstore. We have a used paperback place. But
you have a newspaper?
We do, family-owned Little Rag. If you get
that makes me feel good.
It is kind of interesting because he'll put anything in there that interests him. But you know, you sit off in the woods writing by yourself, and it's nice to get out and realize there are people at the other end of the process who sometimes open the books.
Who read your books. One of the people who influenced you undoubtedly is Nelson Algren.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, his social attitude and everything hit me at the right place.
How old were you when you first discovered?
I think I was just getting close to 15. My father had done something that he felt bad about, so he told me I could go buy any book off the paperback rack I wanted, and it was a paperback of Never Come Morning that had. Bruno Lefty Bicek on the cover without a shirt, and then a sort of blondish woman behind him also without a shirt. And
so this is my kind of book.
And so by accident, I think other than Twain, I think that was accidentally the first literary fiction I probably read.
That's a difficult book, I think. It's my favorite Algren book, but it's a difficult book at almost any age. Did you at 15... devour it, or did you find it tough going?
There were a lot of things I hesitated at because I wasn't sure what was going on or if they meant what I was beginning to suspect they meant or whatever, but so there was a lot of stumbling through it, but I think when I bought it, I thought it was going to be a Harold Robbins kind
of course
of thing,
you did. So. Well, of course,
where there's
you did.
Never any doubt.
Which also says something about you, I think, at the age of 15. What were you like at 15?
Well, I read a lot. My mother had gone to the local library when I was, I think, 12 and given them a letter of consent to allow me to check out anything I wanted, no longer relegated to the children's wing of the library.
Where did that desire come from?
My dad went to night college all my youth at Washington University in St. Louis, and my mom was a book person, and her mom was, so there were always books laying around the house, and it was clear to me that books mattered. And my mother had a fetish about teaching all her kids to read before we started school. So I was already pretty much very fond of books before I ever went off to a school. And it just, if you love reading, eventually you start daydreaming about, would it be possible to write one of these? And
did you do any writing as a teenager?
I did.
What sort?
Pretty mostly crap games in the bathroom kind of stories. I'm sure they were terrible, but
the conventional education route didn't seem to work for you. You dropped out at 17 to join the service.
Why
was that?
I was actually a very good student normally, but my father finally graduated and began to get transferred, and so I went to 5 different schools in 2 years. And by the time I got to the 4th and 5th one, I didn't know anybody within sight. So I just kind of drifted away, and I realized that I honestly did think hippies are getting a lot of publicity. Maybe I should go be a hippie. And then and I thought, well, there
must have been some newspaper you were reading at the time.
And then I thought, but you get paid in the Marine Corps. So the week I was 17, I went down and joined, and everybody had decided it was probably a good idea.
You mean your family decided it was probably a good idea? Would you describe yourself as aimless at the time? Lonely?
Drifting around and meeting someone.
Doing?
I wasn't doing anything horribly wrong, but I was beginning to hang out with people.
With people who had those kind of hippie habits that we all know and love.
And so on, yes.
Yeah. You went in the service with the intention of doing what? Just a new life, seeing more of the world?
I already knew I'd like to be a writer, actually, as pitiful as that sounds, and thought, I need an accelerated experience life. I had read a biography of Jack London when I was 16, and among the things that Jack had done was at the age of 15, he lived as an oyster pirate in Oakland and had a prostitute who lived on board with him for free.
So we now have the early sexual drive, the Nelson cover, Jack London's girlfriend. What was the service like for you? Did you enjoy it on any level?
I did like a lot of it, and I actually did a good job. However, I had what Hemingway once referred to as a peasant reluctance to take orders. And so there were some problems along the way, although I was about to be promoted to corporal when it really came to a head, but...
Came to a head how?
It was drug stuff.
This was, you enlisted during, Vietnam was still going on.
1970.
Did you want to go to war?
I initially assumed that I would want to go to war. I don't know why. Crazy. Well, my father and all of his friends are World War II guys, so. And I actually requested Mass twice to get them to send me, but I had done so well on the entrance exams, they wanted me to go to another program that I ended up being trained for and never even hearing about doing it again. That had nothing to do with what I ended up doing. I liked a lot of the challenges of the Marine Corps. I liked a lot of the people I was around, but it was a very, very strange time to be in the Marine Corps.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Did you enjoy the discipline at all?
I did.
Yeah.
I did.
After moving all those times from all those schools.
Kind of to my shock, when I was at Camp Pendleton, it was extremely slack, very loose. Morale was horrible. Almost anything you want. Guys didn't get out of the bunk in the morning when they were supposed to, and nobody did anything. And it was terrible. And I got transferred to Guam, a Marine barracks, which is like they're at embassies and other things. And it's very spit and polish. And I remember writing home to my mom and said, guess what it turns out I like? I like the discipline much, much better than the lax.
In one of Daniel's best books, they're all... Great. I give you the Kogan seal of approval and Give Us a Kiss, which was written a long time ago in 1996. You say in here, as a boy, and this isn't you, this is not a biography, it's a work of fiction. But the protagonist says, as a boy, I was often jammed up for knowing things, things from books I swallowed straight, haunting the public library for more. Knowledge made me mix poorly. Is that part of what was going on in high school for you?
That was pretty close to my experience in a lot of places. A lot of the people I liked, the guys I hung around with, it really didn't score you any points to. I remember Chester Himes once telling a sad story about when he was in prison that he saw a guy kill another guy over an argument about whether Louisiana was in New Orleans or New Orleans was in Louisiana. And they were kind of on that level of things.
Level of that intellectual conversation, yeah. Did you do any writing while you were in the service?
Not much, no. I did a lot of reading, and shortly after I got out, I began to get very interested again of writing.
You went to college after getting out, or did you start working after getting out?
I started working loading trucks, and then I... would go to school once in a while to get GI Bill. And then
did you go back home and
load
trucks?
I did at first.
Yeah.
And then I looked for the cheapest in-state school with the cheapest in-state tuition and went there so that the GI Bill would go farther. And I was there for 2.5 years, and I got 12 credits, so that shows you.
Well, I guess that college life lacked a certain discipline. What were you studying?
I thought I was going to be more interested in angling toward the law or something. I mean, it was pretty vague, and I didn't really know any lawyers or anything, but I had always kind of got it in my mind maybe that would be something I would enjoy.
Would you get this from Perry Mason reruns or something?
Probably.
Yeah, yeah. What? How then did you start to get drawn to writing? You were obviously, are you probably still writing some while thinking about law, but...
I began to realize that I was going to need something that really challenged me, that really mattered to me, that I was just one of these kind of kamikaze people. I really needed something that forced me to pull hard and really drive, and I eventually realized it's going to be writing.
That's interesting, because you could not have known, in the same way you didn't know many lawyers, did you know any writers?
No, I never knew a writer to talk to till I was about 28. I met one. He was the best one to meet right off the bat either.
You have a phrase in here that goes to I don't know if it's what you might have thought, but people might have thought of you, excuse me for using this word, but it is in the book, a measly bookworm pansy. Did that sit with you? Was that sort of what people...
Well, it didn't sit with me, but I heard it. there are a lot of people who... I was loading trucks and so forth and so on, and it really... They didn't want to hear about what I thought about Fitzgerald's Diamond Big as the Ritz or something.
Now, if you guys read Humboldt's Gift, come on! These other authors started to influence you, but how did you start to develop? And I'm sure it was very halting, and I'm sure they aren't stories you'd like to read to people now, but some of your earliest efforts, what do you remember about those? Were they based on the place you had come from and the people you had known, as all of your books seem to be, or the five that I've read so far?
Yes, they were. And this is, again, I'm not just saying it just because I'm in Chicago, but I had fallen under the sway of James T. Farrell and a bunch of this very realistic depictions of certain kinds of things. And I happened to get lucky at University of Kansas that I had a professor who was sympathetic to what I was doing, but he also said, you know, in essence, what he said is you might want to think about broadening out how you approach this material in a way that gives you a chance to survive, because it was already pretty clear I probably wasn't going to be a career academic. And he said, you know, if you just stick with these absolutely straight, realistic short stories about loading trucks and things like that, it's just going to be it's going to be a very difficult way to survive. And that put the idea in my mind to begin to think about there's this sweet spot between social realist fiction and crime fiction where they kind of, they share interests, and I gradually started driving towards that.
What kind of stories were they? Give me an example of one of those early stories, whether it sold or not.
One that I actually really liked was about a guy who had reached a certain age where he wasn't physically capable of leading the guys loading the dock anymore. And he got phased out for a younger man. And the younger man didn't know how to do the job. And so he had to come over and ask the guy who just got canned to please teach me how to do this job. You know, I got kids and everything. And the guy does. That was the sort of thing I was writing about, kind of.
Did you use those stories to apply to the Iowa Writers Workshop? I mean, you graduated from college before the workshop.
Eventually, yeah.
With a degree in what? Pre-law?
General studies.
Okay. He won the award that year for the general studies, best general studies student.
No, they told me that I would have to do 2.5 years of remedial work in math and science to get up to speed to get credit. And I said, is there some way around this? I said, well, there's science.
How did Iowa come on your radar?
A professor stopped me in the hallway and said that you're not really deeply interested in scholarship, it seems clear, and I like your fiction, and I had never heard of it. He said, you should try to apply. My application got in on the very last day you could get one in, and they accepted me, and so it was, again, just a strange set of circumstances.
What was that experience like? You do call charmingly. In this book, if you want, this is the one, if you've the Maid's version, the other one, the movie one, Winter's Bone, which I have not read because every time I look up the book, I get Jennifer Lawrence instead of the author of it. Give Us a Kiss. In here you write that that had been in the Iowa City, fuck city in that era, grad school days. Did you enjoy Iowa City?
My wife was there. That's where I met my wife.
Yes. It wasn't really like that, was it? It wasn't really like that. What'd you get out of that? Who were some of your teachers and how did they... I know there's had to be a ton of innate talent here, but how did they, a place like that, mold you?
It was the first place I'd lived where being a writer was considered a very good thing to try to be.
Yeah.
I was at the University of Kansas, and I was hanging around in the library once, and the homeless guys would come in there to sleep in the cold weather. And a guy from the school, a campus guy, said to me, you know, they all wanted to be writers too, Dan. And... So at Iowa, even didn't matter how shabbily dressed or how far-fetched your dream of being a writer might look, it was considered a worthy dream to have.
Yeah.
And that meant a lot to me.
Who were some of your professors? Who inspired you there?
Well, let's see. James Allen McPherson was there, Lynn Sharon Schwartz, Barty Mukherjee, Barry Hanna, I know I'm forgetting.
No, that's okay. Yeah. But you felt a sense of, how long were you there?
2 years.
But you must have felt a sense of growth and accomplishment.
Yes.
And empowerment from what you just said, yeah?
Well, even though it sometimes seemed brutal, the way it worked there, the criticism in class from your peers, turned out to, they used to say, no, this is good preparation for when you begin to publish. All these ugly comments, you're going to get them from the rest of the world. Largely true. And so... even though at times I chafed against it while I was there, I realized in retrospect they actually did toughen you up psychologically enough to go forward. And you met other people who wanted to be writers from all over the place, and they had encountered writers who you hadn't, and you'd share your enthusiasms, and you'd find yourself stumbling onto some, like James Salter. Not a guy I would have stumbled onto on my own.
Yeah, but, yeah. You also would find some... pretension there, undoubtedly.
Mm-hmm.
Like in this novel, there's a poet named Chamberlain Post. You write, and again, this is not you, but there's a lot of you in these novels, I gotta tell you. Maybe Chamberlain Post, and Chamberlain Post is stealing the writer's girlfriend, wife, actually. Maybe Chamberlain Post was the final shred of proof that it was truly time to roll my white trash self back to the low-rent world that spawned me and find some raw subject matter.
Yeah. Well, it's, again...
So you get out of Iowa, and where do you go?
Well, we wandered around for quite a while before we ended up... I was convinced I didn't want to write about the Ozarks. I didn't want to write about rural America. It didn't look... promising, and
but you weren't thinking. I don't think you're the kind of guy who was thinking commercially. You didn't think, well, no one's going to buy this. You just didn't want to write about it.
There were days where you would go because the first four were all bombed, you know. So, my editor, who thank goodness had the power to keep me in house publishing, but she said, you know, you sell like a poet, and that wasn't a good thing for a fiction writer. And, so I would occasionally start daydreaming about, well, what if it was the same kind of story, but it was in San Francisco or whatever? And
yeah.
So we moved to San Francisco for a couple years, and it was when I got there that I realized I really wanted to go back to the Ozarks and write about that.
How did you make a living during those years?
We stumbled along on very little. It didn't bother. Unfortunately, my wife was agreeable with this as a writer also. That we just said, whatever we make is what we live on. So we just made that as kind of part of the trip. And when you're young, it's a little more, it wouldn't be as much fun now. But when you're young,
nothing's as much fun now.
That.
And she too, I mean, you met
at Iowa,
mutual love of words,
yes.
if not something more physical.
It would be hard to convince someone who didn't have that to live the way we lived. So.
Yeah, yeah. What was the, if there was one, what was the moment when you, maybe it was your first acceptance, maybe it was your first paycheck, was there a moment when you said to yourself, Jesus, I'm a professional writer, when you thought, I've got a career?
Yeah, that's, well, when the first book sold, it caught me as a surprise.
What was the first book?
It was called Under the Bright Lights, and it had been already kicking around a long time. So it sold, and I remember, you know, pretty much dancing for a couple of months, saying, I can't believe it, they're going to give me money for this. It wasn't much money.
Were you back in the Ozarks by then?
No, we were living in the Arkansas Delta at that time.
Okay.
The other thing that really happened was on this book, Annie Prue had the flu, and so she was looking for something to read, and she read it.
Oh, come on.
No, that's, and liked it and said so publicly, and that altered the way they viewed me in-house a little bit, too,
yeah.
I think. And
did you have an agent in those days?
I did, yeah.
Yeah. But the book world, as you've learned since, this is one of the, to my mind, finest writers to not have a breakthrough bestseller. That has been the way all along. You know, when you Google the book, you get Jennifer, one of his books that was made into a movie, you get Jennifer Lawrence. You have led this life, and I think it's remarkable and admirable. You've never worked another job. You have been a writer.
No, that was kind of part of my dream as a writer was to sink or swim just with writing. I really am a kind of a guy who needed that severe test and to have that tremendous level of devotion to something. I really lacked that and wanted that, and I knew that's what I wanted to do with my life. And the writers that I had grown up admiring so much, many of whom were already gone before I read them, but they led these other kinds of lives that didn't have much to do with campus life. And that's what really inspired me with the kind of the romance of wanting to be a writer. And
the definition of success then is different. You are a successful writer, no question about it. You don't have a big house. You don't take lavish vacations. Do you mind that in any way? I'm sure you'd like to have $1 million, so who wouldn't? But you know what I mean? There mm-hmm. are levels of the successful author. Everybody thinks, you know, you lump in Stephen King and Gillian Flynn and that kind of thing. Money aside, you really do consider yourself a successful American novelist, don't you?
You know, I'm okay with the way I live and everything in terms of houses and all that. And one way or another, I get around more than you might think. And
I thought you'd be scared of all the big buildings here when you got here.
But as long as you're getting to do what you wanted to do, and this conversation we have every once in a while, we reflect back to 30-some years ago when we said, hey, if I can just do what I wanted to do, then I'll do what I have to do to be in a position to do that.
And does it get easier with you succeeding now?
I find it gets somewhat harder.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
you use up a lot of your ideas and juice, and there are certain kinds of techniques of pumping yourself up that are harder to sell to yourself after you've been around a few times. But then they come true. Then one of them happens, and you go, well, but then it did happen, like a movie deal or something that comes
sure.
out of the blue. So
yeah, you do not ever write, I am thinking, with the kind of commercial aim. You were just telling to try to tell a compelling story. You don't write thinking, oh, I wonder if Jennifer Lawrence will buy this, even now, maybe. You
no,
don't, do you?
I never did do that, no.
Because I think that's the clarity and purity of most of your work. It may read like it would make a great movie script, but that's not the reason.
Yeah, I don't think of that doing it. And I was surprised when, I'm always surprised when somebody is interested in trying to make one.
Yeah.
I've had a number of attempts where they couldn't get it off the ground. Because the subject matter I usually write about is not automatically bankable and
right.
All of
right.
that in L.A. So,
well, unless Brad Pitt wants to play Smoke,
that
would
go.
Change things a lot. You right. write in this novel, too, and again, it's a novel. Listen here, the deal with me. I've got just one true love, and that's the art of following my fantasies and scribbling them down. I tell stories, yarns, tiny snickering contes, big wet whoppers. Only eventually, nearly against my will, they shade towards truth. That's a pretty good sentence, don't you think? I'm going to read a few more before this shortened. I could talk to this guy for 8 hours, especially over cocktails. There are a lot of cocktails. There's a lot of drinking. There's a lot of drinking. There's a lot of smoking, and there's a lot of dope in your books. You don't need to be too forthcoming.
I read a book.
You seem to know it. Yes, I read Man with the Golden Arm. You know these people. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know these people intimately. And when you meet these people, and how do they, do you think of them as, is it research?
No, not really. Although
I'm going to just bring up Nelson when he would hang out in the places Nelson would hang out, felt a part of the world, and it really wasn't ever research for him either.
Yeah.
But it's not for you.
Not really. And a lot of those things are things that I basically knew from infancy growing up in the circumstances I grew up in, which nothing horrible about them, just drinking and some of those things were right there. So,
go ahead.
And then when I had never smoked a joint when I went into the Marines. And suddenly I was 17 and there were all these guys from Vietnam and everything in there. So you went from really never having
innocence to
these guys were very experienced in their vices, and even though they were only 19 or 20 or 21, so it was like a crash course, and then it's just a part of everyday life out in the world.
Where everybody lives.
Yeah.
Sure. Right. You write in something. It's not in one of the novels. I think there's an interview with you in the back of one of these about living. I don't know if you still live there, living like down the block from a crack house.
Still live there.
Still live there.
Yep. Got rid of them, but still live there. So, yeah, that's a neighborhood that my family's been in, specifically in that neighborhood since before World War I. And my mom was born 200 feet from my backyard and all that. So even though it's a very plain and not a very prosperous area, I feel completely at ease there in a way that I don't other places.
Do the people around you, do your neighbors know that you're like the writer?
They eventually know.
Yeah.
They know now. We had, at first, before the movie, I had a neighbor for 3 years who was a garbage man. And we'd spoken quite a few times. He never asked me what I did for a living. And we had an ice storm, so we were standing outside front talking, and somehow I made reference to being a writer. He says, "Is that what you are?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Boy, I was wanting to know, but I'd never ask a man what he did for a living." And he said, "I thought maybe he's a drug dealer, but then you don't." But he said, "You don't get enough cars coming by to be a drug dealer." And I'd see you in your, you know, you put your bathrobe on and run across the street to your mailbox every day. And I'd see that, and I'd say, "Maybe he's on disability." And So they eventually they find out.
Is there any sort of, do you and your wife live within any, is there any kind of writers, you know, I think writers' communities have kind of broken up everywhere, even here, unless you live in New York or something. Is there a writers' community down there?
No. Not specifically where we are. If you were, say, over in Fayetteville, Arkansas or somewhere, there is, but not where we are. And but with the internet and everything now, you stay in touch with so many other writers that it fulfills some of those things. And I'm completely conflicted about whether it's good to hang out with writers a lot or not.
I'm a little older than you, and I will tell you it's no good to hang out with writers. Your wife is a writer also. Is she your... Do you have a first reader? Do you bounce things off her? You know, since you started together on this road, do you still do that?
Yeah.
And the value in that is probably indescribable, but...
She can quote back parts of my books to me that I've forgotten. So she understands everything that I've been trying to do from the beginning of me trying to do it, really. So she essentially functions as a first editor. So
let me just read something else and then I'll put this book down. This is the surface of life here anyways, talking about the Ozarks. Back behind the smiles and homespun manners and classic American hokum, there's a whole nother side of life, a darker, semi-lawless, hillbilly side, the side of my homeland that has always attracted me, as it has all the Redmonds and Dawes, two different families from whom I spring and held my respect. The violence and the crime and the bloodshed that goes on in the five books that I've read so far is, to me, more chilling than what goes on in the urban environment, because I see it or read about it every day. Do you get that sense?
One of the key things about a little rural area like I live in is that it's almost always violence from people you know already. So you don't have much stranger on stranger activity. So to me, it always suggests a context in which this has come about to me that I wouldn't get from reading an article about something that happened in the city, or even in another town of my own. But and it's not that it's so prevalent or common or overwhelmingly present. It's just that when it does show up, it's usually so powerful because you'll know somebody related to somebody in the mix.
Yeah, so. Yeah. You haven't plumbed all there is to plumb from your past in that environment, have you?
No.
In some interview, you said something like, well, if I get tired and give up writing, I'll move on to the next thing.
Yeah.
I still have five books to read, but you better not do it till then. Yeah. You're a writer.
I'm always threatening to move to Paris. So.
Oh, what a terrible threat. You must hate that. Oh, you hate that idea. I just want to read one more. You're going to have questions in a couple minutes, but I'm so taken with your writing. This is from the book Tomato Red. She's a woman, young girl with red hair. She got her lipstick out and started drawing. The color she applied I couldn't name, though it was in the pink tradition, I'd say, but above the average pink in pizzazz, like a pink that has been drinking gin since lunch and wanted to dance. Come on! It's funny, but it's also brilliant. How long does it take you to, what's your writing method? You sit down every day, certain time?
Try to.
I would make a guess, I'm not sure. You're not a word count guy, are you?
No, yeah. I really don't worry about word count. I worry about, do I feel like I'm in deep connection with what's going on in the book and the characters? And I write longhand to get it started. Just, I can type faster and I can think clearly, I've learned. And I would rather have few sentences that I enjoyed than a mass that depressed me with how sloppy they were. So.
Yeah. Do you get a sense, when you write a sentence like that, the one I just read, do you appreciate it in the moment? Do you say to yourself, damn, that is one nice sentence?
I'm pretty sure I thought about cutting that one.
Huh?
I'm pretty sure I thought about cutting that one at least twice.
Well, Rick, you're an idiot on the literary front. That was silly. Dennis Lehane writes about you, before we conclude, that you write with such poetic clarity, his prose seems to have been scrubbed in a cold stream. The end of this novel, The Death of Sweet Mister, is the most haunting thing that I have read, and I know many of you have read this, since the end of John Steinbeck's Grapes of Wrath. Remember how that book ends? In the train car with Rosa Sharon? This book, they all will, but this book will stay with you forever. Since we're all here talking about the Maid's version, I'm going to conclude by reading this. This was written in 2001. Mm-hmm. I don't even know if you remember. I like the fact that you don't remember that you wrote this, or I thought of cutting that thing. In this book, written in 2001, you mentioned this black angel. The black angel stood 10 feet tall and stood over a mass grave of mostly teenagers who'd gone to a dance hall to dance years and years and years ago, when dynamite or gas or who knows what exploded the dance hall and the teenagers became charcoal chunks nobody could recognize as any particular person. Do you remember writing that? And has this story that is in the Maid's version stayed with you for your whole life?
Even yes.
Predating this?
Yeah. Oh, I've heard about it ever since I was a little kid.
Yeah.
And I only live two blocks from the cemetery that has the mass grave to the unidentified dead, and they just happen to be buried 75 feet or something from a part of my family, so I'd seen it all my life. I didn't understand the controversies about it until I was much older and people felt I'd reached an age where they would share some of the confusions about the true event with me, but I'd thought about it.
This book, do you find, as do I, and you should buy all the books available out there today. This book differs stylistically, I think, from your previous books. Am I an idiot?
No, I really like Jim Harrison.
Yeah, well, sure.
And I reread, a few years ago, I reread Legends of the Fall, and I think there's only one actual line of dialogue in there. It's where he went back to the old it's storytelling thing instead of the show don't tell. And I realized that he had managed to completely, and I'd read it before, so,
yeah.
And it worked again, and I began to think about that idea as kind of a power narrative of storytelling where the auctorial voice just takes charge of all the elements and charges them forward at you, not without drawing so many scenes, which I would have normally done earlier.
Was it harder to write this book than any of the previous ones?
Yeah, it's one of those. I had two books, this one and a book about Civil War in Missouri that was published in the 80s. Both of them were based on the kinds of things that had been in me most of my life.
Yeah.
And once I finally found a way to get into them, it became really one of those times where you're writing and you look up and it's 2:30 in the afternoon and you don't know how that happened, and those really good times like that.
We got a next book you can talk about?
I'm fiddling with something now. It's in the early stages still, and it's set in Missouri, and it will have. It's actually based on one of the unsung famous people of Missouri. She was famous briefly, and then disappeared from history, and nobody even knows what her name truly was. And when she died, she was the most wanted female criminal in the United States, and. And they can't even find her real birth date or anything. And I've been interested in her in a long time, and this is kind of going after.
Well, I will look forward to that book as I look forward to your other five books. It has been a joy to be introduced to you. I don't often like to do these kinds of things unless Studs is up here, and Studs isn't going to be up here anymore. But I'm really grateful to have been asked to do this, because I've devoured this stuff, and you are now my favorite writer.
Thank you.
Now, I think we have you folks get to ask questions.
So tell us how the Winter's Bone movie came about.
They read it before it was published, the two women who ended up making it, Ann Rossellini and Deborah Granick. And I said, well, I don't know them. And my agent said, well, she made a little low-budget movie set in New York State a couple years ago. I'll get you a disc and send it to you. I really liked what I saw. I liked at every turn, I thought she made the right artistic choice on that. And so I said, well, I think she'd be great for this. And they said, well, there were some other people circling who have a lot more money, and they are interested, but they want you to know up front they're going to change it. And I got the impression that it was going to be changed to where Ree ended up being a bounty hunter or something, so there'd be a sequel. And I didn't really want to do that. And I said, well, no, I really like that first movie by Granick. And so they started putting together the deal, and then one of them said, well, you know, that first movie by Deborah did $40,000 worldwide. They didn't tell me that until after I'd already swallowed the hook. And but it did turn out to be the right choice, and for my taste. And they came down and hung around a little while, and then went off into their where they shot it, which is about 100 miles from where I live, I guess, approximately. And shot it in 24 days. It was another one of those deals, and every deal I've been involved in has been like this, where it looks like it's going to happen at a certain good budget, and then for some reason, a day or two before you're supposed to start, the money's gone. And, and we went through that. So they cobbled together $2 million from friends and relatives, and boy, good thing it turned out well, because it had been a tough Thanksgiving, I think. She'd done 40,000 again, but no, it turned out right, and she had a great eye for talent, and really picked a lot of great people for in there, and a lot of them were just locals she saw and grabbed. I was there for the, I could have been there more. It just happened that 24 days they were shooting, I was sick and didn't want to go. It was February. I didn't want to go stand outside. But I would have been welcome to be there more. I was there for the dinner the night before.
Back here?
So obviously a lot of your work is semi-autobiographical. How do you choose your subjects, though, for the new book that you mentioned? How did you come across that person? Or is it just something that you've heard about your life that you're interested in? Or how do you come about with your subjects?
Sometimes I just think about what events in my own life have made an effect that you still find yourself thinking about them, or what people you've passed through and what circumstances they were in, where you still actually think about them. It's that old saying, the only important things in life are those you remember. And I sometimes ask myself, why is it I remember? The book Death of Sweet Mister was from when I was a little kid. I knew another little kid, and we were running around down closer to his house than my house and wanted some water or something, and we went in the house, and the kitchen was full of stolen radios and stuff. And his dad and another guy were sitting there, and they said, "What are you doing bringing a stranger into the house?" He really got mad and ran him out. And that night I said to my mom, I said, "Man, that his dad just loves radios. I mean..." And I still didn't quite get it, you know. And years later, as I did get it, it began to be give me a character that I began to build around. So those sort of things are unpredictable, but they're in there in your life. And I often just do that. And sometimes it'll be something more contemporary that I've just seen, but. I'm always surprised at the things that I'm sure I will be excited about writing and will drive all the way, and I'm not. I drop them for some reason, and then something that seemed very pale in comparison actually gets its hooks into you, and that's the one that goes. So.
What is your process? You asked, but I don't think you really said. Do you get up every day and write first thing, or do you write at night, or what does that look like as a writer?
When I lived in San Francisco, I wrote from about 3 in the morning till past breakfast, and that's because there were things to do until 3 in the morning in San Francisco. But now I write from as close to dawn as I can get up until I'm satisfied. I am not a person who expects to get 3 or 4 pages a day or something like that. I'm very happy if I have a nice paragraph or something that I'm really happy with.
And where do you write? What physical space?
Our house was, the previous occupant was a reverend. I swear to you, it's not a Charles Dickens. His name was Mock, Reverend Mock. And he enclosed the back porch and put a bookshelves all over with crosses carved in at this top and all of them. And I've been using that now for 18 years, I guess. And... it gets pretty cold in winter in there, but it's a nice, quiet, removed space to work in. But I usually start sketching out longhand line. I usually know I'm starting to get close when I begin to hear the characters I'm sketching say something. Huh. And I'm starting to hear them actually speak, and I'm writing it down. And for that part of it, I'll listen to music or stare at the woods or whatever that feels comfortable. But it's important to kind of get that feeling going before I try to write.
Sure. What kind of social life do you and your writer wife live down there?
Ebbs and flows. If I'm on a book, I really don't go out much.
Yeah.
And then in between, if there's good company around, then I like a lot of it. But I really almost don't even go out to dinners and stuff when I'm working on a book. I'm very careful about the people I'll let myself hang around with when I'm on a book, too, because there are a lot of crabs in a bucket things that you run into, and I don't want to hear that when I'm actually working.
Sure.
We can settle that between books. But
I'll do it. In Nelson's writing, there was a huge, huge blowback from the Polish-American community in Chicago. He said, "How dare you represent our people like this?" Mm-hmm. Do you get any of that from, I don't know, the Hillbilly Defamation League or something? I don't know. The crack dealers,
Actually, usually what I get, when I went out with around the region with Winter's Bone, I was fully prepared to get a bunch of that.
Were you? Yeah.
It didn't happen. It was kind of the opposite. People lined up to say, hey, you should meet my neighbors. You should, you know, because... and then very early on, the first book or two that I set in the Ozarks, we still have a family-owned newspaper, and the Chamber of Commerce had asked him to write an editorial denouncing my representation of the Ozarks. And he said, I will be glad to do that as soon as I catch him telling a lie.
Wow.
And that was the end of that.
Wow.
So I have a question. So in your storytelling, do you start at the beginning and work your way through, or do you have, is it the your ideas that you have the ending and then you work your way backwards, or you're in the middle of the story and then you think, oh, I have to amplify this, or?
Well, I usually do start with, it's important to me to get the first chapter right. And then I often think I kind of know what's coming for at least 15, 20, 30 pages and maybe some vague notions beyond that. I often also think I sort of know what the ending might be, and that it's almost never going to be the ending, I've now learned. But I sort of have one in mind. But I learned about the characters with each page you accumulate, and so that begins to change things that can come ahead because they're no longer the same somewhat unformed personality I had when I started. So I have to remain open to that and honest about that. Ree Dolly was supposed to be dead at the end of Winter's Bone. I mean, I thought all along there's no way she's going to end up floating face down somewhere. But as I went on and began to understand her and her world better, I realized that that would just be, you know, just forget that you ever thought of that because it doesn't feel right now that you're here. And you have to be trust yourself enough to do that when you get there. But I usually don't know too much about it. I do know writers who write the ending first and then try to build toward it. And that seems to have worked very well for them, but I don't think I could do that.
Couple more questions.
Can you talk more about your military experience? And the reason I'm asking is, did you ever see the movie Platoon?
Yes.
And I'm haunted by a certain scene in there, and you refer to the smoking and the drinking and the vices of how young men had to go to Vietnam and you know, sort of maybe dealt with it kind of one way or the other, and whether you could make any connection of sort of those kinds of experiences with sort of our young soldier of today.
Yeah, it's, I actually have written a couple short stories attempting that have been published that attempting to kind of do show a Vietnam veteran and a contemporary veteran and where they cross over a little bit. But the era I was in Marine Corps, 70 and 71, Marine Corps historians often refer to that as the dark era for the Corps. And desertion and AWOL and insubordination, and I saw guys beat up officers and stuff. I mean, normally you don't see that, but it was very high, and drug use was very, very high. And when I was at Marine Barracks on Guam, you could go to the roof at night, and you'd see guys just lighting up dope. And there was only one Marine Barracks, and then the rest were sailors. And you'd just see it every night, like bivouacking on the Potomac, only they were firing up joints all the way down at night. Because if you were caught in those days, it was a very serious offense. Even a couple of joints could have been a very serious offense, depending on who you were caught by. But that kind of response to the experience... and there were a lot of guys messing around with heroin and stuff, too. And it used to be routine that when some guy's stereo's arriving from Saigon PX, they all used to do that. The interested parties would all be clustering around waiting for that stereo to arrive from the Saigon PX. And so there was a lot of that around. And I don't actually know any young guys right now well enough to have gotten their details of the way things are now in great detail. I haven't. So I think there is some, obviously there's always going to be some similarity to the ones who've seen a lot of combat. I didn't see any combat other than three times we had to put on bayonets to go to the fences in California to keep my friends out, which was very difficult to do, actually. People you kind of were hoping would hang around with you later. So it was very complicated, and I'm sure it's very complicated now as well.
Let me ask you one final question, and thank you for being such a great audience and for being readers. Enough about you. Tell me a little about your wife's work.
Katie's got two published books, one set in Greece, where she lived for quite a few years, and it's published by Joyce Carol Oates and her husband with their Ontario Review Press. And then she had a novel called Dahlia's Gone, set in the Ozarks, about an interfamily murder that no one wants to believe that it really could have been done within the family. But it's not a mystery or anything. It's really a thing about how do we deal with the facts of this and so forth. They're both very good books. And
maybe she will be up here on stage some year,
right,
winning the
That'd be great.
Humanities Award. Thank you all very much. Go buy the books.